Okay, so we're going to solve the same problem now, but this time we're going to use the law of conservation of mechanical energy. In other words, we're going to identify and analyze the energy states of the system before and after the hanging mass has fallen some distance, and we're going to see if we can use this analysis to help us get the acceleration a different way. If I think about this hanging mass falling some distance, oh, we'll just call this y, right? And now, let's see, the hanging mass is now over here, right? And so it's fallen a little bit. It's not really too important how much it's fallen, essentially. I'm going to try and find the velocity of the hanging mass at that point, or the velocity of the pulley at that point. And what I can do, right, is I can use that to help me solve for the acceleration. And so I'm going to set up an LOL diagram to help me solve for that final velocity. If I wanted to know, after it fell 10 meters, right, how fast is it going? I can do that with conservation of energy. So let's go ahead and begin by drawing an LOL diagram for the system. All right, and so I want to think about, initially the system is at rest, right? The hanging mass is released from rest and it falls some distance. Y. And so my initial state, right, my initial state here is going to be at rest. Okay, but the hanging mass is still, it has not fallen yet. And so do I have potential energy, kinetic rotational, or kinetic translational in this initial state? And the answer is I don't have any kinetic of any kind, right? Neither the pulley or the mass are actually moving. But I do have gravitational potential energy, right? The hanging mass is going to fall. Right? It has the ability to move. And so at this location, right, this is going to be like my initial state right here, the mass has gravitational potential energy. Now, after the hanging mass has fallen, does it have gravitational potential energy? Right? And so we're assuming this is our y equals zero state, if you will, essentially. So let's say this y equals zero right here. Well, then no, it doesn't, right? It's all out of gravitational potential at that point. So we're going to say no, it doesn't have any more of that. Now, does it have rotational kinetic energy? Well, the mass doesn't, but the pulley does, right? As that mass is falling, then the pulley is rotating. And so we're looking at our final state, right, as it's all moving, hasn't hit the ground yet, though, right? Right before it hits the ground or right before it's, essentially stopped moving, we're going to have both rotational kinetic energy. This is in the pulley, and then translational kinetic energy in the hanging mass, right? The hanging mass is falling, the pulley is rotating, and so we have two objects, and each of them have one form of kinetic energy. So together, I'm going to call, again, the pulley and the mass and the Earth our system, because we're looking at the combined energies of all three of those things. And because we're ignoring a external work, we're no external friction or external air resistance, there's no work. So I know that the initial potential energy, right, is going to be equal to the final rotational and the final translational kinetic energy. That is my energy conservation equation. And so I can go ahead and plug in the expressions for each of these to solve for, I'm trying to get the final velocity of the system because I know I can relate the velocity to the acceleration. And so I'm going to plug in my values. The potential energy at height A or position A would be the little mass, hanging mass, little m, times g times y, how far away it was from wherever it fell. The rotational kinetic energy of the pulley, right, this is the pulley, will be 1/2 I times omega squared, where I is the moment of inertia of the pulley. And then the translational kinetic energy of the hanging mass would be 1/2 mv squared. So I'm going to, before I do anything else, I'm going to plug in the moment of inertia, right, of the disk. That's going to be 1/2 mr squared. This is the pulley. And I'll use a lowercase r here, as I've done before. And then I know that omega, right, v is equal to r times omega. In other words, the linear velocity of the hanging mass is related to the angular velocity of the pulley by the radius. So I know that omega is v over r. And I can plug those in right here. And that would give me this expression, which looks hopefully a little bit familiar by now. Right, 1/2 big mass, pulley mass, times v over r squared plus 1/2 mv squared. I'm going to cancel those r squareds again, and then I'm going to have a v squared term here because the squared will be distributed to both the top and bottom of that fraction. So mgy is equal to, it's going to be 1/4 the mass of the pulley times v squared plus 1/2 little mass times v squared. And so if I rearrange for v here, right, I'm going to factor v out to v squared. So that'll be mgy will be equal to v squared and then 1/4 big M plus 1/2 small m. And I'll go ahead and just divide both sides by that, and I'll get that and take the square root that the velocity is equal to mgy, the gravitational potential energy in the hanging mass, divided by 1/4 of the pulley mass plus 1/2 of the hanging mass mass. And so what I can do now is if I wanted to solve for the acceleration, I'd keep going, right? And I'm going to. If I was just looking for the velocity, I could plug in all my values right now and I'd be done. It doesn't really matter, you know, if the problem said, you know, if after it fell 10 meters, right? We don't know why. Y wasn't defined in the problem. But we could plug in a Y value and then the masses and solve for the velocity now of the pulley or the hanging mass, right? V or omega at any point, which is really cool. But what we can do now, right, is if we want to solve for A, I want A. Well, I know, right, that I can use kinematics to relate my velocity here to my acceleration. And so I know that, right, the, let's see, we can use the VF squared equals VI squared plus 2A delta Y equation, right? I know that delta Y in this case is just going to be Y because my final was zero. So I can just plug in my Y there. And I know that my initial velocity was zero. And so my acceleration, right, we would get the equation that acceleration is going to be 1/2 vf squared, right, divided by y. And so if I plug in my equation for v, this is, you know, this is technically vf, if you will, think about it. It's the final state that we're looking at. I can plug that into my expression for a, and I'll get that a is equal to 1/2 this whole term, right, mgy over 1/4 of the pulley's mass plus 1/2 of the hanging mass mass. Right, that would be all over y. And so this, I'm going to move this over here just to make sure that we can see it okay. I'm going to move this up over here. If I divide the numerator by the denominator here, the y's will cancel. And then if I essentially multiply the 1/2 by everything, everything on the bottom is just going to become 2 times as big. So that means my acceleration will be equal to mg over 1/2, right? Because 1/4 times 2 would be 1/2 mass of the pulley plus the mass of the hanging mass. And notice, this is the exact same equation that we derived in our previous example when we used Newton's second law. And so really cool example of how we can now use energy or a force analysis to help us solve problems in analogous ways. And so you can, I'd like you to compare and contrast the solutions for these two problems and find a way that works best for you. You should definitely feel comfortable solving both of these problems using both of these approaches. Okay, that concludes our series of videos for problem solving involving connected objects and rotation.